thank you very much to KPMG for inviting me to be a part of this discussion. And it's striking to me that the subject of intelligent automation is really, I think, at an inflection point. It's not a new technology, of course, but it is a technology that's changing very quickly. And today, we'll learn about how some of those changes apply in the government space. Of course, you may have heard yesterday that Apple is just the latest company to make a big play in this space. They are introducing a new device that will compete with the Amazon Alexa program, with the Google Home and others. I think it's very exciting to see that government is moving into this space with the rapidity that it is. It's maybe they're moving into this space maybe more quickly than any other technology space that I've seen in the 12 or so years that I've covered the federal government, the executive branch. One example, last summer, almost a year ago now, I interviewed a woman named Mariella Malero of Citizenship and Immigration Services. They have a virtual assistant named Emma that has a 90% success rate in answering questions for people who go to the CIS website. And it is so effective and so conversational that people ask it out on dates. So that gives you an idea of the success that agencies are already enjoying with this. One of the agencies that you'll hear from today, the General Services Administration, has just started a pilot program, and Justin Herman, I don't want to steal Justin Herman's thunder, which is hard to do, quite frankly, but they set up a pilot program in this area, and they expected maybe a handful of agencies. They were prepared for up to six, a half dozen agencies to participate. And he told me on Government Matters last night that they got almost three dozen. So there is a lot of demand here, there is a lot of interest, and there is a lot of desire for understanding how government needs to deal with some of the challenges that the private sector, quite frankly, doesn't have to, governance and liability and privacy issues and others. We'll touch on each of those at various points during the discussion today. And the goal for the government people that are here today is for you to take actionable information back to your agencies this afternoon to really be able to move forward and not just to say you showed up and learned something at this event, so that you can go back to your organizations and embed these ideas and principles in your agencies. So be ready to learn, be ready to think, and be ready to participate. We don't want this at all to be just something where you sit there and soak up the information. Be ready to engage with all of the panelists and all in all of the conversations, and as Connie said, on social media, where these discussions now always take place. To kind of set the stage for you for where we're going to go today, to give you some context as to what this all means, I would like to introduce to you the Government Intelligent Automation Lead for KPMG, Kirk Everson.
So first off, I'd like to welcome each and every one of you this morning and joining us. It's a beautiful day outside, so hopefully the commute into D.C. wasn't too bad. What I wanted to do today is really try to level set the rest of the agenda today with some of the terminology that you may hear. So the term intelligent automation is a pretty broad term. So let's start with a video that would kind of get you thinking about the future of what this has to bear. And then also I'll talk about the different classes of automation that we have. So could you cue the video, please?
Brains. Yes, that gray and white between your ears, that matter. Arguably one of your most important assets. These brains have been responsible for some pretty amazing life improvements throughout the years. Like this. This, and yes, even this. Then came along human brains like these, and gave birth to these brains. Computer brains. Back then, as with any unfamiliar thingamajig, it was scary at first. But humans adapted, as humans do, and life went on. Along the way, brains like these evolved these brains even further, allowing them to mimic human activities and take over repeated tasks. Things like this, and this. In the near future, they may be programmed to do things like this, and this, but probably not this. And while many of these easily bored brains would say, good riddance, it's caused these curious brains to think, will I still have a job tomorrow? Or will robots take over the world? Yes, jobs will change, and there will be painful dislocations in the short term. But our lives will be radically transformed for the better. After all, who wants to do the boring or dangerous work? Not these brains. Instead, they'll be freed up to do the more important thinking. And these robot brains will get to do the more menial and mundane thinking. Companies will no longer have to waste resources and talent on low-level jobs that produce little value. They can now invest in new technologies, making the world more efficient, safer, and generally a better place to live. Yes, the cognitive era is upon us, and one thing's for sure, human brains aren't becoming obsolete anytime soon. They still need to invent and build these other systems, interpret their findings, evolve them, and keep them in line. Our brains will never stop questioning. For starters, what does all this automation mean? How do we plan for change? And how do we get ahead of it? We might not have all the answers now, but we're figuring it out, just like we've always done before, by putting our heads together and thinking forward.
So I think it's interesting when you look ahead to the future, some of the possibilities, and while some of that video talks about the displacement of workers, I would say that it's not really about labor arbitrage. Automation is more about labor augmentation. And so think about the message in that video around knowledge workers doing things that require more brain power, if you will. So before we get into what we feel is intelligent automation is, I'd like to go over some myths of what it's not. So again, intelligent automation does not replace humans. Labor augmentation is critical, especially in government. Think about the hiring freezes that we're all under. Think about the budget constraints. Think about the backlog of tasks that are sitting on someone's desk and getting bigger and bigger every day. So the human intervention in automation is critical for the success of this technology. Of course, you saw a lot of robots in the video. This is not a physical robot. These are software agents. These are things on a platform that integrate at certain levels. These are data-heavy cognitive engines on some cases. So these are not physical robots, although there are some case studies around cognitive and hardware robots being conjoined. The other myth is, well, I've got a bunch of bots on my networks running around unsecure. And I'll get into this when we talk about mainly class one robotics process automation. But essentially, the RPA piece of this runs on your networks, operates within your security environment, and has complete and full audit logs. And then finally, I believe Francis touched on this earlier, this is not new for public sector. This is something that's been in place for years. With the advent of newer technologies, cloud computing, it's becoming more into the forefront in the latest years. So, a bit of an eye chart, but what I wanted to do is, again, level set what we categorize, at least at KPMG, the different classes of intelligent automation. And again, this is our perspective at KPMG. You'll see different analyst perspectives as well, and different private sector companies have different perspectives. But for us, it was interesting to look at this and say, well, how can we categorize this so we can talk about this intelligently? So let's start quickly with class one. So class one is essentially robotics process automation. Everyone's probably heard of RPA. Class one is essentially automation of very transactional, routine, mundane tasks that are rules-driven, that have structured data, and that don't really require much human intervention to automate these processes. So an example would be automating the reconciliation of a subledger to a general ledger. If you've ever run an Excel macro, this is a very similar technology to an Excel macro. When you go up the stack, and again, this is not a maturity model, but when you go up the stack to class two takes what was in class one and adds things like natural language processing and pattern recognition and learning assist. So what that means is, let's say, for example, I'm a business analyst and I'm running an RPA bot on my desktop. Over time, the bot will say, hey, I've noticed this really repetitive task that you've been doing over and over again. Would you like me to automate it for you? So adding a bit of learning and pattern recognition to the bot itself on the network. And then again, natural language processing is key for ingest of large amounts of documents and optical character recognition through things like PDF and Word documents. And then class three, that's really the, and let me give you an example of class two before I move off of class two. So think about, you've heard of virtual agents or chatbots, right? So you've essentially added natural language processing to something that is automating something in your back office. So doing a password reset through a chatbot would be a way to showcase that use case. And then class three is essentially the cognitive piece. That's the IBM Watsons of the world. You'll hear from IBM Watson today. But that's heavy data sets, very large cognitive engines, AI, and machine learning that are involved in the class three piece of this. So again, these are ways for us to talk about this. And some of these technologies overlap among the three classes, but it was important, I think, for us to level set the day. And so again, we've talked about this initially. You know, these are things that can help us with a number of things given the environment we're in. You know, the citizen engagement, reducing those backlogs, making sure that we can keep up with citizen demands. 24/7, 365 is the way that these things can run. So they don't take holidays, they don't take weekends, they are working however you want them to work. Speed, these things work typically a third of the time that a human would operate. So when you'll see some videos today from our vendors, Automation Anywhere and Watson, some of these in action, you'll see how fast they move. Quality and accuracy, the bot will do what you want it to do, right? You will train that technology to do what you want it to do. So essentially, it will do that every single time. And obviously, there's some maintenance to go along with it, but it's going to operate as you want it to operate. And again, employee satisfaction. So those routine, mundane tasks that folks don't normally want to do, well, the bot can actually take over some of that and kind of have a virtual assistant on their desktop to help them do some of those things. And so I think it's important to kind of talk about that. And one other thing I wanted to mention about government agencies is there was a very large offshoring move back in the late 90s, early 2000s, where shared services were moving offshore due to the savings involved in the direct cost of employees. Well, government never had an opportunity to really do that. So now government has the opportunity to really jump in and take on automation and essentially leapfrog the commercial environment. So, you know, I would argue that government is actually somewhat ahead of commercial in that way. And so I think it's important to remember that the use cases in government are plentiful and the opportunity is now.